graduates across 400 districts in the country and hiring and training them at our expense for software development roles through innovative ways, through a lot of technology-based interventions, gaming-based intervention. First generation kids who have never seen anything beyond their own district or own place. And as a model for skill development for the 21st century, the IT industry has led the way. So this is some very, very good learning. We are trying to see that how we can apply it in the vocational skills area and taking some of those learnings and applying them as pilots, but then ultimately to scale up. Now the other notable aspect and a key contributor to the industry's success is the agility with which the industry scaled up to attain international standards, because all of them must be benchmarked. Your market is outside, you are being compared with international players, then you better benchmark with international standards rather than say I'm number one in India, it doesn't mean a thing. Today there is much talk about the need for occupational standards benchmarking with global standards. What are we trying to bring into the vocational scheme or the skills building in this country? East, number one, everything should be standardized to what we call as the national occupation standards. Each of these national occupation standards across 31 sectors have been mapped through what we call as sector skill councils, where industry representation, small, medium, large corporation representation, academic representation, NGO representation, private sector player representation is all there. And they define the number of hours of competency they need to build before they are certified and assessed to international standards. We have entered into agreements with multiple countries outside so that youth can get a certification which is Indian as well as an American or an Australian or an Irish or a British, Swiss or Austrian, German. So I think for different types of skills, different certifications, so that the mobility of the workforce is possible with those recognitions of competency. Now the IT industry recognizes this on its own in a very natural way right at the outset, and assimilating the global practices in project management, because it's not just the skill, it's beyond the project management. And quality and acquiring international certifications went a long way in establishing our credibility at the global stage. They believe you, they trust. Now NASSCOM, like I said, has been a part of the industry. And it was started in 1988, has completed more than 25 years, we celebrated about a year ago. And this has promoted the India brand abroad in addition to the companies themselves. NASSCOM has worked with the government to shape the policy, taken steps to expand the pool of talent, set the direction for the industry vision, because collective responsibility for all of us representing the industry. Understand the emerging trends, provided thought leadership, encouraged entrepreneurship, and assisted innovative startups. And we see the startups today mushrooming across multiple zones, next to the universities, next to the IITs, in addition to the startup, and the funding has also become a lot more easier than before. Of course, much needs to be done, but the IT industry has demonstrated good templates for successful nationwide collaboration. Now, the convergence of several relatively new technology developments, including the smartphone revolution, the emerging Internet of Things, social media, cloud computing, and the big data analytics are impacting the Indian society and business in a very, very transformational way. As increasingly connected world of devices, emitting large amounts of information that can be processed absolutely in near real time, this enables businesses to take more intelligent decisions. When you see in the retail sector, you see in every single sector how the data is playing a very, very critical component. An analysis of this large volume of data in real time, what kind of decision-making, decision support system it gives. Now, youth in the villages may never have seen a computer, but on Facebook, on their smartphones, you see them. City kids, on the other hand, are learning, shopping, and navigating their way to new places using handheld devices. Because the power of this medium, power of the smartphone, the beginnings of exploitation is just happening and is only going to be skyrocketing with the kind of penetration it has achieved and with the kind of power in the hand of every single individual, with the kind of price points at which they can be meaningful. Whether it's today ordering vegetables or calling a cab is a call away, buyers and sellers are more connected than ever. It's a promising time for entrepreneurs and even for us to know, as a community, as a group, to know what is the best way to go where, to access what at the best price, etc., etc. I think some of the younger people today might have not even gone to a bank, a physical bank, a brick and mortar bank, as an example. At the same time, there are several development challenges, and IT, in our opinion, in my opinion, offers immense potential in this space. Now, if we were to step back and review the returning success of India's IT growth story, one blemish that we would spot is the benefits of the country's economic emergence have been uneven. Poverty and unemployment still remain big challenges. The rise to prosperity has not been inclusive enough, and everybody talks about it, everybody sees it, everybody understands it. But then the need of the hour is the replication of the success story. But this time, our blue-collar workforce at the center stage. Always put the client at the center stage, the haves at the center stage, try to address, try to take them further. But I think, how do you put the blue-collar at the center stage and look at applying some of the learnings? I think the recently launched Make in India campaign offers a great promise in this regard. And for this to happen, our much touted demographic dividend will require to be properly skilled before it can take its rightful place in the global arena. And that's what we are doing at the National Skill Development Corporation, where I talked about the sector skill councils, 31 to date, and funded as a debt funding 206 partners, with about 3,300 or 3,400 training centers across the country, across multiple sectors, but for a common purpose. In 10 years, they would scale to about 90 million per year, in addition to all the governmental efforts, the state government efforts. What we are trying to do is to take every single occupation standard and the qualification back through a National Skills Qualification Committee and the National Skill Development Agency under that, populating with a after screening to National Skills Qualification Register, where anybody, any stakeholder can look at it and then choose what they want to do at a level of competency they think they are good at and get themselves certified, including recognition of prior learning where you might have gone through an informal way of learning or informal way of getting skilled. I think we have learned quite a bit in terms of some of the tools and techniques through the innovation ecosystem. We are funding some of the innovations also, more as grants rather than as debt there, and also learning from Germany or some of the other countries where vocational education at the grassroots level, where 60% of the top rank people in corporates there have come through the vocational scheme. Why can't it be done in this country? I think technology has a very clear role to play in all of the scaling up, whether it's mobile learning, e-learning, immersive learning, simulators, multimedia-based learning, gamification, local language support. And these are some ways in which we are trying to see how to spur the learning and encouraging each of these. The rural or the distance model, a district level model may be slightly different from a city. But at the end of the day, if you can connect them and through the rural broadband network or the broadband as it is getting deployed, the power of the connectivity and power of the handset in hand with the content from anywhere and any place is going to be the way, and scaling up at a speed which is unprecedented with the quality and ultimately provide jobs also locally, followed by mobility as an option, as a wish somebody wants to do, rather than a forced migration which leads to a lot of its own problems. Talking of inclusion, the recently launched, before I go to that, the company law policy of 2013, which talked about the CSR funds, 2% of the profits being deployed by companies which have 2 years of successive profits for education and skilling, has also become a reality. And companies are beginning to plow their CSR funds in addition to other things like health or water or anything into education and skilling in a big way. Even in Tata's, we have started a skilling initiative called Tata Stride, which is a completely non-profit by the Tata Community Initiatives Trust under the Tata Stride brand. And our vision is to scale up to 1 million youth to be skilled and deployed as quickly as possible with the right sectors, the right content. Demand side coming from both within the group as well as in any part of the country or any part abroad. So there is a chief operating officer driving this with all the collective learning of every single company within the group itself. We are also not shy of partnering with any other institution because it's for a common social good and a common social cause. When we talk about the inclusion, the recently launched Mudra or the Micro Units Development and Refinance Agency Limited of the government, this has a potential to be a great changer for the country. Vast sections of our population living in villages and interior areas have been excluded from the benefits of a formal banking system, have no recourse to insurance, credit, loans and other financial instruments required to help them establish and grow their micro businesses. Just to get a sense of the opportunity, a survey was done in 2013, reported close to 5.8 crore micro business units across the country, as against an organized sector that only employs 1.25 crore individuals. I think 93% of the workforce in this country today is in the unorganized sector and only about 7% is in the organized sector. So if India could harness this free spirit of enterprise, and I think Mr. Prabhu also told in the morning that every Indian is an entrepreneur, and we have to unleash the potential of these entrepreneurs and offer some guidance, support, training and financial assistance, the potential to get an immediate jump in GDP is there for the asking. This can really step up the employment, the dissatisfaction that exists, and the ability to contribute, but more importantly, through a market connect, which is absolutely necessary. From a technology standpoint, the immediate task at hand is to build appropriate systems to assist in the process of efficient lending, borrowing and monitoring of distributed capital. Now, with the development comes more money in people's hands. Example, farmland taken over by the government and villages get handsomely rewarded. Good financial planning can enable a permanent exit from poverty. In cities, two low-skilled jobs and more earning members in the family signals the need for better management of funds. So we can get all of this. The recently launched Jan Dhan Yojana comes at a time when inclusive growth can be driven if implemented correctly. I think all of this we must absolutely keep always at the back of our mind. Implementation is the key, it is not the communication. Communication is essential. At the end of the day, people are going to believe when I get the benefit in any part of the country, and implementation is absolutely, and implementation at a scale and a quality. Several well-thought-out features, including integration with the direct benefit transfer, credit insurance and pension, interoperability through the RuPay debit card, and the Aadhaar-enabled payment system, mobile wallet, and the unstructured supplementary services, service data-based payments, simplify know your customer norms, and overdraft facility promise to overcome the pitfalls that each attempt at financial inclusion face. Whole question is, how do you integrate all of this at a scale? Then keep measuring the outcomes through dedicated measurement systems, concurrent audits as the system gets deployed, and finally share the learning so that it's very easily available to anybody to look at it in real time. Now, with the mobile phone ownership scheduled to shortly breach the 1 billion milestone in our country, our ability to touch and transform the lives of our citizens is very imminent, and IT is at the forefront for enabling the financial inclusion. A network of business correspondents armed with applications on their mobile phones and micro ATM devices are reaching out to the farthest corners of India and essentially bank the unbanked. But then, special programs for the northeastern region, special programs for Jammu and Kashmir, special programs for affected areas of the country are all being targeted with specific interventions, and I'm happy to say that the beginnings of cooperation between the various ministries and the central government and collaboration between the central government and the states, we are seeing the beginnings of those, which was sadly absent in the past. And the duplication was a way of life, leakages of funds was a way of life, but I think we are seeing the beginnings of some of these collaboration and cooperation for a common purpose is happening. Now we are, as a country, at the crossroads today, with almost every citizen holding a powerful computing device in their hands. Yet on the other hand, our natural resources are stretched to the limit. Sanitation and waste disposal are poised for major technological disruptions. How do you look at that from a technology perspective is again an opportunity which should not be lost. Now, cleaning up our neighborhoods is no longer a nice to achieve option, but a do or die mission that has an indelible impact on health costs, life expectancy, tourism inflow, and employment generation. The government is certainly tuned to this sense of urgency, as evidenced in the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan on Gandhiji's birthday. From advocacy and awareness creation through digital campaigns and social media tools to execution, monitoring and governance, IT can play a vital role in the success of any of these social programs. At the same time, renewability, recyclability and reuse are the only ways to prevent our deepening natural resources from choking the life of our society. The next wave of innovations in IT drive the creation of efficient, optimal and intelligent, clean and renewable energy solutions. We heard with regard to the distribution of the nuclear power, renewable and the fossil fuel waste a while ago, 40-40-20. Can we inspire a set of young, motivated social entrepreneurs to create innovative products and services that address some of these core challenges of our country? And now we are seeing people coming back, leaving the corporate sector and wanting to partner and participate in the social efforts in a big way. It's not just one corporate, but a number of entrepreneurs, whether it's in education, whether it's in skills, whether it is in healthcare or some of these newer technologies, including an organization which is an alumni of IIT, which is looking at construction industry in a big way as an example. Manufacturing will certainly be looked at for sure. Now, agriculture has been one of the mainstays of our economy. While we might have the second largest agricultural land in the world, our agricultural productivity is woefully low compared to many other countries, and all of us know that. Now, when you look at the recent report that was on the rice productivity, we are placed on the 27th place out of a leading 47 rice producers in the world. Controlled environment agriculture is a technology approach that shows great promise in addressing this productivity issue. Now, CA is practiced predominantly in greenhouses and within buildings. The essential principle in CA is to maintain optimal growing conditions throughout the plant life cycle. Digital technologies can help effectively manage these controlled environments. A number of sensors can be put in place to monitor the key parameters that feed into the computer control system that maintains the plant's growing environment. In a recently conducted pilot study, a team that I work closely with has been able to successfully deploy low-cost, digitally controlled growing units for growing green fodder for marginal dairy farmers in one of the most ecologically challenging areas in central India. The initial results have been very encouraging, with milk yields showing tangible improvement as an outcome or an output. A digital farming initiative holding out greater promise from both a productivity and a sustainability point of view is precision agriculture. In variation with the current practice of one-size-fits-all approach, where the farmer manages the crops with the lowest common denominator, precision agriculture facilitates much more nuanced interventions. Unmanned aerial vehicles fitted with sensors can map out the terrain as well as capture a wealth of information that is related to the geospatial variation in the soil moisture and nutrition content. Holy grail in precision agriculture would be to develop intelligent decision support systems that can crunch this data and provide optimal crop management plan. One of our teams is working with some of the largest tea plantations to make this a reality, specifically in the Northeast. So, how do you bring together the domain experts from agriculture, any other domain, IT experts and social transformers to develop interesting technology solution and workable business models to take this highly promising technology to the small farmer? Healthcare, which Dr. Devi Shetty will definitely cover, is another sector where technology has created a vast impact. Increasingly, robotic devices are deployed to perform precision surgeries, which were restricted once to a very few specialist surgeons across the world. Satellite imagery is being used to predict epidemics months in advance, which enables us to take preventive actions and minimize the impact of a disease. Exoskeletons such as the ones you have seen in movies like Iron Man have a practical application in enhancing the capability of people with disabilities and enabling them to live a normal life. You will have recently seen the article on how 3D printing technology was used to visualize the organ structure of conjoined babies before doing the operation to separate them. With promise of economic growth and prosperity comes the challenge of meeting the demands of an increasingly aspirational and digital savvy society. Intolerance to corruption, demand for transparency and speedier and easier access to public services will grow because more information, more aspiration and more aspiration, more demands, and we need to make sure we understand that. India will need to go digital to meet the aspirations of the new resurgent India, because that's what they are growing up and starting their life with. This will include creation of a digital infrastructure, digital delivery of services and provide digital literacy to all the citizens. We have seen over the last few years, we are seeing the evidence of these transformational impact that digitization can bring in. Let's quickly look at a few noteworthy examples. The Passport Seva project through the 77 Seva Kendras across the country that won the National Award for e-Governance for Outstanding Performance in Citizen-Centric Service Delivery is hailed as a testament to the innovative use of ICT to transform the way citizens receive services from the government institutions. The project helped the Ministry of External Affairs to create a milestone of processing more than 1 crore passport service applications in a year. Bhumi is another noteworthy e-governance project for the computerized delivery of 20 million rural land records to 6.7 million farmers through 177 government-owned kiosks in the state. I think this has brought multiple benefits to the citizens and is being used as a reference model for computerization of land records across the country. Breaking through tradition and bureaucracy, when I look at the Indian Railway Catering Tourism Corporation, they have implemented an online railway ticketing service and scripted India's biggest e-commerce success story. Sheer complexity and scale of operations, the site can handle over 7,000 bookings every minute. And agility with which it has embraced mobile-based technology makes this a commendable example of innovation in citizen service delivery. Akshaya, an initiative of the government of Kerala, is an IT dissemination project. Was started with the mandate of ensuring IT literacy for at least one member in each of the 6.5 million families in the state. And today, Akshaya has expanded its scope to serve as a vehicle for rural empowerment and economic development. The project is a catalyst in creating massive economic growth and creation of direct and indirect employment in our state by focusing on various facets of e-learning, e-transaction and e-governance. Now, the cities are engines of economic growth, and it's an irrefutable fact that economic growth will be accompanied by rapid urbanization. Realizing that our existing cities are bursting in their seams, the country has woken up to the challenge by announcing the creation of several new cities across India. Now, these will be smart cities. Smart cities are cities with intelligence, which implies the capture of accurate information and the ability to act on it. Effective resource management is the key to the sustainability of these cities, and demand response software can help in this. Buildings, devices, processes and products within the city will incorporate sensors to enable identification, tracking and monitoring of objects and resource use. Now, these sensors will report and analyze the data collected to help explore how best to manage and influence patterns of resource use. I think the Internet of Things essentially will open up opportunities for improved building management, more efficient traffic flow, clever ways of provisioning basic services, more efficient healthcare, better water and waste management and policing. I think by all these examples, clearly information technology can directly impact developmental challenges, but the success stories are taking place when all the relevant stakeholders are in sync. And these include our educational and research institutions, governments, the business, the NGOs, etc. And I think we heard about the education system and the school system also this morning. Today we need to go beyond islands of excellence to an institutionalized system across the country. I think everyone must get the benefits of this unquestionably. I think I just would be failing in my duty if I did not point out the flip side of things. The internet's all-pervading presence also brings with it the threat of cyber attacks. As systems become more complex, more interconnected, and handle more information, their vulnerability to exposure to vulnerability increases. Cybersecurity awareness will have to go hand in hand with digital literacy, and this needs to be provided right from the school level. In this context, it is worth mentioning a pilot course on cybersecurity awareness that we have launched for science graduates. A number of these students are first generation graduates aspiring for IT careers. The diagnostics test conducted at the start of the course revealed many minimal awareness of cybersecurity issues. The course helped quickly elevate awareness and understanding of cybersecurity. The absence of the prerequisite mathematical and analytical skills proved to be a hindrance in assimilating more advanced concepts. It's clear that we will need to start cybersecurity education at the school level and invest in strengthening the mathematical underpinnings vital to create top-flight cyber experts. A huge unmet demand for cybersecurity professionals who can configure, manage, and monitor IT systems from a cybersecurity perspective will need to be very, very rapidly addressed with the kind of positive moves that is happening in the deployment of IT or incorporation or using IT. We also need to develop expertise in intrusion detection and cyber resilience. Much research and advancements are happening in these areas and we need to quickly get up to speed and stay at the top of our game. We need, for instance, to explore if we can create learning systems that look for warning signs and detect and stall potential intrusions before they even happen. IT today has permeated the very fabric of society, and right from being the first plaything for babies to performing financial transactions, smartphones have pervaded all aspects of our lives. Technology skills will soon become a basic literary requirement, similar to learning languages or basic mathematics. At the start, I spoke about the technology and the society in transition coming together and rising like a phoenix on the huge aspirations of a very young population. Technology is creating skills into a level playing field of opportunities and creating India into a level playing field of opportunities for the haves and the have-nots. Building a vast circuit of possibilities that is waiting for the last mile connect. And Indians, as we have already proven, have innate abilities to succeed in the technology space. So essentially, what I am saying is we live in very, very exciting times. We have the unique opportunity to carve our own futures. And this is perhaps the biggest gift of information technology. So as individuals, as organizations, including those like NIAS, as a nation, what we build is in our hands. Our failures and successes are our own. Thank you so much.
Let's open now for discussion, comments, questions.
Derived a lot of benefit as a result of the work done by people in this country. Has India itself derived commensurate benefits from the application of IT or not? If so, what are the whole points which are coming in the way of our realizing much greater benefits out of the IT revolution?
So that's an excellent question, because one of the things when we formed our TCS, and as an industry, you know, we are talking a lot more is the need for IT deployment in the domestic market, whether it is the private sector or the government itself. We have done a number of projects. One of the few organizations that took some of those very, very challenging projects in the country. The processes within the recipient organization was completely broken, including the government. The practices that were followed were very, very questionable. I think think there was no transparency in some of the procurement practices. And the only procurement practice you would know is if there was a tender that is coming out, you would get a call as a CEO, I can help you so long as you give me a percentage. This was the way. So I think consciously quite a few of us said that let's build the capabilities and let the market matures, or selectively we'll take those projects and do it because we think it will be very transparent, very open, and we will be rewarded for what it is. Second problem is we take defense as a service industry where we are talking about IT department or manufacturing in the industry. Again, it was a closed shop as well as the private industry was concerned.